Oscar and Helen, our matriarch and patriarch of generations back.
Yay. So, good job, guys. We're here to remember the family, all the good memories that we had, all the fun memories that we had. I found a poem. I'm not that good at writing poems. It's by Mary Fry. It's called "Don't Stand at My Grave and Weep," which I already am.
Don't.
I'm trying not to. Don't stand at my grave and weep. I am not here. I do not sleep. I am a thousand winds that blow. I am the diamond glint on snow. I am the sunlight on ripened grain. I am the gentle autumn rain. When you wake in the morning hush, I am the swift uplifting rush of quiet birds in circling flight. I am the soft starlight at night. Do not stand at my grave and weep. I am not there. I do not sleep.
Yeah, you're good.
So, as we go, the person that is the one that will be giving the memories for each brother and sister, we'll have a picture. Show everybody the picture. Give your memories. Hopefully there are really good ones, funny ones, you know, ones that even some of the people remember. Then we'll lay a rose at each headstone, and then we'll take the balloon. So with that,
I would like to invite the first cousins, our soon-to-be elders, have one last opportunity here in a way that we never will again, to remember and honor their parents, and in this case, their grandparents. I have one quick little story, and I hope I'm not stealing somebody's memory that wanted to say this, but I read in something that Aunt Dorothy wrote to one of her sisters that when the kids were growing up, and they said the brothers and sisters were growing up, that when they were asked to go and get wood to bring into the house, Oscar, our patriarch, would hide nickels in the wood pile for the children to find. And that was their motivation and their treat. And they always giggled and had fun finding the nickels.
Well, I lost a nickel back then.
Yeah. Any other?
Well, we have one thing I remember about Grandma, she'd make Kool-Aid.
Yep.
And what she would do is she'd put the Kool-Aid in, and she would put in a can of 7-Up and then finish with water. I mean, I still do that to this day. Just really, you
know, how it's done.
That's how it's done. Yeah, you just.
Close yours, Rocky.
Yeah.
Your version.
I'm Karen, and I'm the sixth oldest grandchild. Not crazy about that. To come because I wanted her to be the oldest grandchild present. I called her 3 times. I have never called her 3 times. But anyway, it will become apparent that I am the oldest grandchild very soon this afternoon. I'm shorter on memories than those of you that lived in Mozanine, but I do have some and I'll share them. I remember Grandma as a beautiful, white-haired, soft-spoken woman in a pale blue house dress. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Always had my favorite cake, which was hot milk sponge with brown sugar frosting. There wasn't one today.
I apologize. I went to get it and I found the pineapple cake recipe and decided to make that.
Don't let this happen again.
We got to come back next year.
Next year. Yes. My mother always described Grandma as an angel. So I I grew up just knowing she was. Mm-hmm. I recall a Christmas tree in their apartment on Main Street as being at least 10 feet tall, with at least 1,000 gifts under it. That's what it looked like to me. They had a music box, mm-hmm. Mary. Painted top. I don't remember the song that it played. Maybe somebody
Vienna
here.
Waltz.
See, I'll tell you why that's important in a minute. We could take it down. We couldn't take it down. Grandma and Grandpa would take it down, play it for us. We couldn't even touch it. But I loved it. I loved the music. I found out in recent years that at least one younger grandchild was allowed to touch it and play with it. So either they mellowed, Grandma and Grandpa, over the years, or I was a clumsy kid. I haven't decided which. I never touched the music box. She knows the song. She's touched it. She's played with it.
And I own it.
May I touch it? Grandpa Rockman intimidated me, and I don't think that's any surprise to any of you. He always invited my cousins out to the shed, the garage, workshop, and back, and we loved going, looking at all the gadgets and watching his projects, but I always hung back just a little bit, intimidated. And would you believe this, to this point, he'd give Ron and me a nickel. I always took the nickel, but I remained intimidated. I was always intimidated, no matter what the circumstance. I came to Mosinee every summer. Those were absolutely wonderful kids' summers here in Mosinee. My dad would drop me off from his Greyhound bus at either Aunt Lil's or Grandma's. And one of those memories is when Virginia and I went to a carnival one night, and we ate all the wrong food, and we ate a lot of it. And Grandma held my forehead through the night while I was sick.
Aww.
She was an angel. Until then, only my mother had held my forehead when I was six. So Grandma won me over there. This is sort of like what John was saying. Grandma and Grandpa Rockman gave us the gift of family first. And our moms and dads kept it going. I hope we can do as much.
Question, do you still have a nickel?
I gave it to Rick to make up the difference in the twins.
You know what?
Busted.
It's that nickel. No, it's Grandpa.
They sing that song. There's a little red robin.
Oh,
there's a little
yes.
Robin. Is he by the door?
Little red robin, got a tree by my door. He's waiting for his mate to return evermore.
Oh, I have a different
tune. So remember, please remember that I'm lonely too. Like the little red robin, I'm waiting for you.
She sang it.
I just want two brief memories. Grandma Rockman, when I would go there, would send me next door to Bob's Bakery and get a fry cake for her. She loved fry cakes. And Grandpa, you mentioned the shed. I can remember, I was telling Scott, the smell in the shed. And not too long ago, I was somewhere and that scent brought it right back.
Yeah.
Well, one thing that brought back, I used to go every Friday night in Mosinee. What we did is we went to the theater. That was the only thing to do. And living, you know, out in the country back then, so I always stayed at Grandma and Grandpa's on Friday night.
And
played
with the music box.
So anyway, I stayed there one night, and I don't know how many of you, and I can't remember if it was Gunsmoke, if you remember the show Gunsmoke, or if it was Paladin, or, you know. Anyway, I had a game I played with myself, and I would try to jump out of the chair before the gun was pulled. It was just something I did. And so we're watching this, and then he goes to pull the gun, and I, of course, jump out of the chair because that's my thing to do. And all of a sudden, in the middle of the night, Grandpa wakes up laughing hysterically. And it was
him thinking about me, thinking I had to get out of the way of the gun because it was going to run. He did not realize it was a game I played with myself. But I mean, you didn't hear Grandpa laugh. I mean, that was a special rare moment that I got to spend with Grandpa. You know, it was just him laughing hysterically because of the way I jumped.
Who can talk about Oscar without a can of sardines?
Yeah.
His dirty little pocket knife that he used for everything.
I forgot to tell Jam.
Well, one of the ones I had, especially about Grandma Rockman, was she was an angel. And when we'd come up, like you from Illinois, and Pat chimes in on this, how we'd come up and spend our summers taking turns, spending it with some of you guys or spending it there. And the greatest smell in the world, she knew we were coming, was the nut bread. Oh man, there was good sponge. There was a lot of stuff, but you walk in and smell that nut bread, she'd have flour all over her apron. You'd run and give her a hug. Oh, I'm going to get flour on. We didn't care. Seeing her and getting the nut bread, that was really good. Or sleeping out on that little side porch next to her and rolling down the hill before the bank was there.
Yes, I remember rolling down the hill.
That was so much fun. And of Oscar, John and Chuck and my brother Bob and Aunt Lois and I think Aunt Dork all went shopping in the big city of Wausau. And there was some department store that had entrances on two streets. So they played Let's Hide from Little Ricky. They did. I couldn't find them. They went out a different door. I didn't know what to do, so I had a nickel. Not a nickel.
Everybody had a nickel.
I took the bus to the paper mill in Rothschild's and said, Oscar Rockman's my grandpa. He works here. Take me home. Well, he wasn't working, but they found me, and a state trooper came and picked me up, took me to Mozanie. They found his thing. And of course, John and Chuck and Bob got in a lot of trouble. I was not much, I was probably a little older than Rocky is now. And but I just, I
mean,
can
the
do
panic.
This. Well, I knew I had that nickel, and I knew.
I'm not talking about your panic.
And the rest of them, they were pretty nervous. What happened to that little Rick? But anyway, those are two of our great memories. That, and like I say, Pat and I, and Bob, we all enjoyed coming up and spending our summers here. And Pat called Mozanie our spiritual home, and in so many ways it really is. So, and that's why Rocky's here every year. Thanks. Thanks for all of you.
Well, I'm not a first cousin. I'm a second cousin. It all started with Oscar and Helen, and then Myron. Unfortunately, Myron passed on at a very, very early age. I was only 2 years old. I'm the second great-grandchild of Oscar and Helen. The first would be Vicki Rockman, myself, Bruce Rockman, Heather Rockman, and Christy Rockman. Wonderful family. So unfortunately, I don't have any specific memories of Myron because he left so soon. But I do have a lot of memories of Oscar and Helen. We two spent our vacations here every summer with the family. We stayed with Lois and Bob, and Cindy took care of us little kids running around. And I know that the work shed was mentioned a lot. That's where we wanted to go. We were out at Lois and Bob's, but we wanted to come down so Grandpa could take us into that work shed. And those smells, as you have, they were just wonderful memories, and I can smell it right now. So I want to thank the family for being here and for us all to be together. And that's all I have to say.
Well, I'm speaking for Uncle Riggs. Sally asked me to speak for him because she couldn't be here, because Aunt Lucille just can't make the trip and they can't leave her that long. So Reginald Rockman was born February 22nd, 1915. He is remembered, and by my sister Sharon, that he was so small when he was born, the nuns baptized him immediately and did not use a middle name. So it is Reginald Rockman. He passed on November the 22nd, 1983. Greg's married Lucille Windorf on July 28, 1938. Aunt Lucille is 100 years old now and doing good. Greg's and Lucille had two children, Sally and Tom. Greg's drove a Greyhound bus until his retirement. Greg's loved his family and especially his grandchildren. Greg's enjoyed baking bread, rolls, and pies. And Aunt Lucille said that's when she started to gain weight. Greg's also enjoyed gardening and playing cribbage. Greg's and Lucille both had a perfect cribbage hand the same year, something that's hard to achieve. They played cribbage every morning after breakfast. Uncle Riggs was a very kind and tender-hearted man who was greatly loved by all.
I have a memory of Uncle Riggs also. It's more of a photo memory. A few years back when I was putting together the video for my grandpa Don Rockman's, what would have been his 100th birthday, I found a photo of three of the brothers. There was Greg's and Greg's Greyhound bus, and if you look in the background right behind them, there's a neon arrow pointing down at the three brothers and the sign says liquor.
Oh. Could have said beer, of course.
That's a keeper.
It's on the DVD that I made for Grandpa's birthday. If anyone has a copy, you've got it. The next one
would be Dorothy.
We have to take
the balloon. So, grab the balloon.
I'm going to be 80 in September. I forgot the picture. That's what I'm doing. I'm sorry. If you want to see a picture of Mom, Dad has a few pictures of the brothers and sisters, but that's my my excuse today. Mom was the twin of Donald. She was either the fourth or the fifth child, Helen and Oscar, and I never asked that question. Maybe somebody here knows who was born first, Donald or Dorothy.
I think we can find out for you if you really want to know.
It was something that crossed my mind as I was writing some things about her. The two things my mother was most proud of in her life, and I will tell you that if you asked me that question, I would say Dan and Diane. My mother said, being a Rockman and being Norwegian. This is true. Dan and Ron and I came third and fourth. I'm not sure about that order. Her pride in this family and in every single member of it grew with each year. She thought being Norwegian was so good that she once selected a doctor based on his last name. She knew nothing about him and no references, but he had to be good. He was Norwegian. I saw in Mom that keen Rockman sense of humor. Our moms and dads shared it with each other, and then they shared it with all of us. And the most fun was seeing them in uncontrolled laughter. That was the best. And I think we've all witnessed that and experienced our aunts and uncles doing that. I think on slightly different levels, each of us has inherited that humor gene. Huge highlight in Mom's life, a trip to Norway and Germany with Aunt Dolly. They arrived laughing. They spent time with us in Germany. And they had us in agonizing and in embarrassing laughter. Absolutely embarrassed in the little village we were staying in. I wanted to walk out of the bank, but I couldn't. And it was your mother that started it. It was funny. But get this. They made us laugh the entire time they were with us. Then Bob and Sue Koski picked them up and put them in blue beanbag chairs in the back of a blue van decorated with orange flames. And they went off to Heidelberg laughing.
Yes.
And then they went off to Norway, and I never heard anything more other than they had a wonderful trip. I'm sure they were in hysterics the whole time. Dan is here today, and I'm so thrilled because Dan and Diane were even a greater, a huge highlight of their lives, of her life. She was so proud of them. When we moved from Merrill to Stevens Point, she was the happiest one in the family. brief story about Dan. He's really a good guy.
You're up there now.
He was the favorite. Oh. He was out-and-out favorite. He was passed me up the day he was born, I think. When it came time for my mother to be told that she needed to sell her house and move into assisted living, we took a vote, and he got to do it. Everybody knew Dan could do this. He did it, not easily. It was not an easy task, but he did it. And I suspect he will do the same with Bob and me someday.
That's part of the story. The whole story is they invited me out for breakfast. they had all made this plan, right, that I was going to tell Grandma it was time to move out. And they said, yeah, come, we're going to have pancakes. And so we all went out for breakfast, and we talked and talked. It's, oh, it's time for Grandma to move out. She really just can't take care of herself anymore. And everyone's nodding their heads, you know. And at the very end, you go to pay the bill. And, oh, by the way, Dan, you need to go tell Grandma now. Yeah, that was the whole story.
They had so much confidence in you, Dan.
That was, yeah.
But I wasn't totally honest. We knew what he was going to do. Yeah. He didn't know what he was going to do. But,
so if I ever ask any of you to take a walk with me, that will be more of the story, right?
So, yeah.
I was going to offer him, but he just made an offer you can't refuse. Lock it in. Mom was a professional woman and worked most of her adult life. She was dedicated to community service. She golfed and bowled in leagues. And next to Moe's and Edie, she thought Stevens Point was the most wonderful place in the world to live. But she always knew she'd come home. Moe's and Edie. Next to the life she gave me, this family is her greatest gift to me. Bottom of my heart, I mean that. And to all of you who have graciously accepted Bob and Bob, we thank you for that. I'm going to leave you with Mom's motto. Face life squarely, love most everyone, trust a few, and paddle your own canoe. Oh, do I sound like her?
Yeah.
Just adding to that, the Rockman women, they have the best sense of humor of anybody I've ever met in my life. Mm-hmm. Every one of them had a good sense of humor.
Well,
over anything.
All generations.
Yes.
I was having a nice luncheon with some friends at the hot tea shop one day, and a raucous laughter came from a few tables away, and it was really raucous. These women were enjoying themselves, so I had to look, and it was Mary Louise, Lois, and Tara, and Tammy, laughing hysterically. It's this rocking gene, and I'm grateful.
Well, you know, and if I remember correctly, there's a story that your mom and Aunt Dolly tried to tell us about their trip. We never heard it because they would start telling it and would laugh so hard they never finished the story.
I believe that.
Yeah. We do not know.
What, and maybe we don't want to.
Yeah.
Karen, we have to say hi to Ron.
Please do.
Yeah, that's please Ron that. Beebe's grave right there.
He would like that.
Yeah.
David
Norris
would have missed this.
Oh, he'd
love
it.
Yeah. That was Bob's idea. Our adopted
friend. Brilliant.
There's an interesting story about Grandma Sheep. She used to golf, and golf in the ladies' evening. And then they'd have dinner and so on, and they'd talk and whatever and burn calendar. At one night, after golf, she threw her suitcase in the trunk and slammed the trunk. Well, her keys were in the box. And she didn't realize this until after supper. She went out and, oh my God. And she got to her car. It was a Pontiac. And a gentleman and his wife were walking by, and she said, I beg your pardon. She said, what kind of a car have you got? And he said, you got an automobile. She said, well, you opened my trunk for me, put up one.
Oh,
they had the wind at their back.
Yeah. That's the Rockman women. That's right.
Do you have
have any of the grave rubbings that they got on that trip? Did you ever see? That's I heard about them. They did a bunch.
Your mom and my mom, yeah.
We don't have any.
I'll see if we can find them. I don't know if we'll have one or not.
Okay. I always wondered about that.
Next one you go to is Anna Lillian.
Oh,
I'm so sorry.
Right straight back.
Right back this way.
If you know, this is Aunt Lil. She was my grandmother. I was the first grandchild of Lil and Ben Drew. And like most of you from out of state, I used to spend quite a bit of time in the summer up in Wisconsin. And I play, of course, mostly the Huber girls, because they were the closest. And just play from the time we got up in the morning until the sun went down. And I loved being up here. I've got a little note that my sister sent. It says, okay, Nanny, here is something short and sweet. You can, wait a minute, that's just for me. Never mind.
Go ahead, lead on.
Here, come on.
Okay, Lil Drew, Anna Lillian Rockman Drew, was a special lady to many people. She was special to us because she was our sweet grandma, sweet mother to our mom, Jean Christensen. She was a special aunt to a lot of you. I remember it always sounded funny hearing someone say Aunt Lil when we were visiting in Mosinee. She was always happy, whistling or singing while she did things around the house. She tried to teach me to whistle and I still can't do it.
Put your lips together.
She was half of the first set of twins born to Oscar and Helen, twin sister to Lyle. We're told she was like a second mom to her younger sisters and brothers, since she was one of the oldest. Grandma Lil always made time spent with her special. She loved to crochet and make items to give to loved ones. She taught us how to crochet many times. We'd forget in between visits, so she'd have to show us all over again. She loved playing cards, and we loved playing cards with her. Summer vacations at Aunt Dolly's cottage always included Grandma Lil, and evenings usually included playing cards. She joined a bowling league when she was in her 60s, never having bowled before, and she had a lot of fun doing it. Grandma lived to help others. She was always helping someone and didn't like it when she was older and couldn't help like she used to. We love our Grandma Lil very much and feel she was a wonderful example, along with her sisters and brothers, of how to live a positive life and enjoy life. This picture was one of the reunions at Dessert Park.
Thank you. Yeah. You know, one of the things I remember about Aunt Lil, like Grandma Rockman had the wonderful nut bread. Aunt Lil made the greatest pie in pie crust.
And
she would take the trimming and the pie crust. She'd put all the clippings and put them in the oven and cook those and put cinnamon and sugar on them.
Yep.
And oh man, they were to die for.
So good.
And the best iced tea in the world.
Yes.
Oh, I still make it her way. Yeah.
That's so good. And the rolls. She called them Matilda Reinschmidt's rolls. That's the recipe. Matilda Reinschmidt's rolls. And Aunt Lil made them and they were dinner rolls.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Can't even buy any of them.
I remember what a good sport Aunt Lil was. I played a lot of games with her, and she was just a fun-loving, good sport. The night that I met David, I was actually playing cards with her when my girlfriend called me to go to Buzzy's. And I met him that night, and she had said, just go, have fun with your friends. I mean, we were playing a game of cards, and she was just always a good sport.
I remember her making pancakes all the time. And Judy, you and me, every morning, first we started off saying we had to eat as many pancakes as our age. Well, once we got up to around 10, 11, and Judy was 4 years older than me, she said, I think we're gonna change this. Couldn't eat that many cookies or pancakes.
Nancy?
I don't know if this is another music box kind of story, but do any of you remember having being sent out into the chicken coop to dig worms so Uncle Benny could go fishing?
Yes.
Or was I the only one?
No.
I'm beginning to feel a little strange. You too?
Yeah.
Okay, good.
And when they said, we're going to have chicken dinner, don't go in the backyard for a little bit.
I found a turtle down in the river one year. Just a, you know, regular old size tortoise, about that big round. And I brought it home. I was going to make it a pet. And Grandpa was having a fit. He said, oh, you can't do that. And Grandma says, hey, we'll fix it. Don't worry about it. So we got out her old wash tub, put in some grass, put in a little bit of water, put my turtle in there. Well, the next morning, I go out, and the turtle's gone. Grandpa says, see, I told you, you can't keep those kind of animals as pets. It's just gone now. And I cried for a while, and I thought, okay, it's gone. Wouldn't you know it, we had turtle soup for dinner there. Yeah. First time I ever had turtle soup.
Yeah, that turtle would be with you.
Just about.
It was a one-day cat. Yeah.
Don't judge me.
Bill was a second mother to us.
She was
always with us, helping my mother take care of us.
Saturday night, mm-hmm. She came and washed our hair, gave us baths. She was there all the time helping Mom at the closet.
And then she helped me when I had a daughter, Julie. So when Julie had her daughter, she took the name Lillian and made it Liliana. And so I have a Lil in my house to this day.
Actually, I've got one memory. When I was growing up, when I saw when Aunt Lil would come over to Grandma's house, or Aunt Dolly, as you know her, she would always, when she would come over and start talking, I remember that she was the fastest talker. I always would say, you know, Aunt Lil, how do you talk so fast like this? And she says, sometimes I talk so fast, I talk before I think, or things like that. And she's, but she was a very fast talker. I also remember that she would just trounce us and scramble too. She would be really good. So
I know, along with that fast talking, Grandpa always says she talks so fast, she says things she hasn't thought of yet. That's about like what you were saying.
It reminded me when I was really little, I had a very, very high-pitched voice. And it would set a, you know, the car key alarm that we could find where your keys were. My voice would set it off. Oh. She would send me into the room to find her keys. Just, Michelle, go in there and talk. Find her keys based on the beeping.
She was great. For three generations, she got to see her great-grandchildren, you know, well into their life in school age, high school and junior high.
And her nephews, so she talks about how she trained Ray. Potty trained
him. Yep.
She
kept
him at her house for a week, and she potty trained him.
And
all
those wonderful things. She was just a
consummate mother, grandmother,
aunt.
She was
a
wonderful lady. She is. Like all the
Rockman women, past and present.
Yes.
Thank you,
Rick.
Thank you, Rick. Okay, the next one will go to is Lois. She's right in back of us.
I couldn't decide if I wanted her high school graduation, or that was taken 6 months before she died. Mm-hmm. So there's kind of the progress mm-hmm. between the two. And, you know, John talked about how when Deb called him, you know, bang, he went into the mold right away. And I called him and I said, you know, Johnny, we're all supposed to say something about our parents. So can you write a poem for Mom? Silence. Well, okay. I'll have to think about some memories. And, you know, he kind of started talking about his process. And so I thought, well, I'm not a poem writer, but I came up with some memories and then I put them together and he said, go for it, sis. You know. So I have the life stages of Lois Annette Rockman Valtner. January 9th, 21 to January until June 20th of 2006. I don't know how many of you have read, and I can't think of the name of the book. It was one of the classics that a lot of us had to read in high school. In the first line in the first chapter, it said, "I was born." Mm-hmm. Anybody remember what that, I mean, it's, you know.
Was it Catcher in the Rye?
No, no. But anyway, that came to me as I thought about my mother's stages. And I said, she was born a baby girl, a child, a younger, and an older sister. Joyce and my mom argued continually, who was older? Well, I worked for a funeral home, had access to records at the courthouse. Joyce was the baby. So my mother was a younger and an older sister. She was born first and Joyce second, making Joyce the baby of the family. Next came childhood. She became an aunt at the age of 9 when our first cousin, Gerald Rockman, was born. Next came her teenage years. Mom had a lot of fun in school. She was very active in drama and music, and she learned to play the violin, and I never got to hear her play the violin. On August 2nd, 1941, Mom became a wife when she married my father, Robert Valtner. Next, she became a mom when John Robert Valtner was born, followed by Chuck and Mary, better known as Cindy. She was mom to John and Chuck. She was my mom. The one activity she and I enjoyed most was shopping. And we shopped. We really shopped. Mom's next stage was that of mother-in-law. My brother John married Nedra Menke. A month later, my brother Chuck married Virginia Wysocki, and she really loved and welcomed her two new daughters. Then came the moment she was so proud of. She became a grandmother. Michael Allen Valtner was born. Now, let me think. I believe that's the year I graduated from high school, so that makes Michael will be having his big 5-0 this year. Next came Dan, followed by Tara and Tammy. And of course, Mom and I had to teach Tara and Tammy our favorite activity of shopping. And they learned well. I remember Tara being in a stroller, and I'd be looking at dresses, and she'd be going through. Now let's recap the stages so far. She was a baby, a child, younger and older sister, aunt, wife, mother, mother-in-law, and grandmother. As if this wasn't enough, she wanted to be a great-grandmother. After all, many of her siblings had great-grandchildren. Her dream came true when Luke Junyon was born, followed by Charles and Morgan Rose. Next came Max Valtner. That's my brother Chuck's grandson. And they live in Baltimore, so it wasn't as easy for her. But Dan and Marla drove, they were gonna be in Chicago, so they drove as far as Rockford. And then I took Mom to Rockford, and she got to meet Max. After Max came Avery. However, she never did get to meet Avery. As Mom went to be with her Lord and Savior 4 months after Avery was born. There is a sixth great-grandchild that Mom never knew in her earthly life. Sammy, brother to Max and Avery, was born 2 years after Mom went home.
John, Chuck, and I miss our mom very much, as I know all of you miss your moms and dads. Mom was so beautiful inside and out. She was also kind and classy. I loved her class and wish I could be more like her. I'm sure she had the same wish. If there is a Bible verse to describe Mom, it would be Matthew 5:9. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they should be called the sons of God. The things I believe people remember most about her is her graciousness and her sense of humor. It was, please don't make me laugh unless a toilet is nearby.
That's it.
That's it.
That's it. They did that. They did that.
Her humor and laugh were so genuine. In fact, all 10 of the Rockman siblings had a good sense of humor. Put Uncle Lyle and Uncle Don together and it was non-stop laughter. This is a trait which has been passed on to the first cousins, something we will all share as the years pass. Her biggest and most important achievement was that of a child of God. She went home to her Heavenly Father and Savior on June 20th, 2006. We will all miss you, Mom. Wish you were here. But we know you are much happier now and are laughing with our Lord.
I remember the story about having the toilet close by. Three of the sisters were over at Grandma Lil's house playing cards. And at her house, it was like a circle. You went from the kitchen to the living room, through the bedroom and into the bathroom, then another bedroom and back to the kitchen. And something started them laughing. And first it was just a giggle, and then they started laughing harder and harder. Pretty soon it was a mad dash to the bathroom. All three of them fighting for position to get in there first, and all three of them dribbling as they ran.
Cindy, I want to back up your shopping story. Aunt Lois was a poet as well as John. Yes. And she made a poem called Let's Go Shopping. And it was a poem that would, every time things got bad, they would say, let's go shopping. I don't know where a copy of that poem is, but...
Actually, that was for my 50th birthday.
Oh, was it?
Okay. And it was about me, and then every stanza ended up, and then we went shopping. And we did. We shopped.
She wrote a poem for Mom and Dad's wedding anniversary, too. We had out the patio. That's one thing, and it was a beautiful poem. So she also was a poet.
Yeah. I did not inherit that. My brother John did, but I just didn't. In fact, I made birthday cards for my children, and I had to call Judy and say, okay, this is what I've got, help. And then with Aunt Lil, the pie, I don't know, it was Mom and probably Aunt Dor, Aunt Toots, I don't know who all was there, and Aunt Lil had a raspberry patch. And she said, I'm gonna make you guys a raspberry pie. And so, you know, they picked the raspberries, she made the raspberry pie, and there was one piece of raspberry pie left from the one she had made before. And my mother said, if I have that piece of raspberry pie, can I still have a fresh piece of pie? And Aunt Lil said, of course. So she ate the raspberry pie, and as she's eating the second raspberry pie, she's, you know, I really don't care for raspberry pie.
Yeah.
I remember.
But she was a gentle and sweet always. She would help anybody. Tom Davis died in town. No, Tom Davis was ill, and so was his wife. She took a full meal, salad, the main meat and potatoes and the dessert and everything, a number of nights a week. She did that for a long time. She took it, and nobody even knew she did that. But she was a good woman. Yes, she was.
I wonder where that was. Well, I didn't have a whole lot planned. One of the things that a lot of you here have said over and over is about Aunt Dolly. And it was your moms and dads that gave her that name. She was a little girl at the time, believe it or not, she was actually kind of shy, and you've probably all seen the picture of all the kids. She's looking like this. You can see those long banana curls. And her brothers said she looked like a little doll. And so they all started calling her Dolly. So it's not just her, because she was a doll to all of us, but to her brothers and sisters. So we have all of your moms and dads and your grandmas and grandpas to thank for that. That's how I never could figure out. We come to Mosinee and she called her Aunt Dolly. And in Illinois, she was Jenny or Virginia. I couldn't figure out what her name was. And I wanted to mention with Oscar, of course, he had a special name for her, Buster.
Yeah.
Because she had her long banana curls, but then she got a haircut, and it was in the days of Buster Brown shoes, so she had Buster Brown hair. So a lot of you might have also known her or heard Grandpa Rockin always refer to her as Buster. Rocky, who's not here, every time we say a blessing for every meal, this is hi to Grandma Buster in heaven. So, and you know he's Rocky, because he's a rocker. So that's his middle name. And I want him to know, because we live so far away, that he hasn't missed reunion since he's been born. We've missed very, very few. We love it. We drive 60 hours to be here 30. But it's worth it. And I want it to be worth it to him. And to many of you, I'm a first cousin. He's a second cousin. So most of his second cousins, or his generation, are 40 and 50. He turned the big five
old. And older.
And older.
So when people talk about you guys getting old, say, oh yeah, well my cousin's only five. So it'll be a touchdown for all of you, as you will for him as years go forward. Again, Pat wanted us to mention how we love coming up here for the summers, being with so many of you, being with your moms, your dads, and especially John and Chuck. I remember Dick and Bruce Rockman would get some new clothes, and they would go, as they got outgrown, down to Bob Miller, as he outgrew them, they'd go up to John and Chuck, and I knew I was next in line. I didn't have to break in shoes, my Levi's were soft and faded. It was wonderful. We had care packages that we would mail back and forth throughout the year, and then summer would come and it was a real bonanza. So, great fun spending time up here. And as you know, my dad died when I was young. And so it was the family support for a long drive for her to be with her family, be with her brothers and sisters, be with Oscar and Ellen. That have meant so much to us. That's why we come back. That's why we love all of you. And we're blessed to have Norm and Celeste. And, you know, as we became part of their family, they certainly became part of ours. And just enriched it so much for all of us. I'm so glad that we can all be here. And somewhere. Oh, right here. I moved to California first. But I like both. We got Mom a place eventually right next to the ocean, and some of you have been there. And so I brought her some Pacific Ocean sand and seashells. And also, Levi and Zane get first pick on some of the shells that we promised. But if any of the kids want some shells from the Pacific Ocean that Rocky and I gathered right out by our house, you're welcome to them. You can put it Tower 17 Social Club and you can see where these shells came from. It's about as far away as the flag post is. So she was the adventurer and the traveler. And when my dad died, everyone said, come on back. And she did. So, anyway.
She was an 80.
Oh, yeah. She was a pilot. That'll tell us a crazy story. But anyway, yeah, my mom learned to fly. And when she was pregnant with me, they said, pregnant women shouldn't be flying. So, as a lot of you know then, back then, they said, sorry, you can't fly because you might have a baby on the airplane. Or something. Or that the change in pressure would be too hard on her. So those were the days. But then all of us have gone on and got our pilot's license. You know, I sold airplanes for a while. So there was a flying spirit. The Rockman spirit flies high, like the flag.
Grandma Rockman, the Sears store, Melissa, and
And you walked in and were looking around, and your mother looked at the mirror and said, "Mother, pick yourself out a dress. I'm going to buy you a dress." And that wasn't easy. She was a single mom raising four children, and that was hard for her, but she bought her mother a dress.
We were talking about things that are going back. Somewhere I've got a brown paper bag. It was written in 1937 or 38 that they would cut up the bag to write letters on it with pencil and wait till they had enough in there to mail the letter back to one another. And they didn't have a lot of paper, but they would use the paper bags.
Yeah. And I think she was a poet too, an artist.
Oh yeah.
She was definitely a strong artist. I found her sketchbook. California, just beautiful artist. She always did a lot of the rose modeling, and she always did the knight helmet.
Well, when Grandma would talk to, when she was talking to somebody on the phone, she'd write out in shorthand. I'm like, "Grandma, what language is that?" She's like, "Oh, that's just something I learned." But it was shorthand that she learned when she was doing secretarial work over the paper mill. And then the other thing she'd also do whenever she's talking to somebody, she would always sketch something out. And that's what Alicia's talking about, is a knight's helmet with a plume. She'd always do it in this particular style, and it was the only I knew it immediately was hers just by the style of how she drew it. And she only had this particular style. So it was always something very special.
She wrote letters back and forth with our daughter Shannon for a long time. And a paragraph had a little picture of the margin of what she was talking about. All the pictures all the way through. Her birthday card and everything, she always had some type of little sketch of whatever she was thinking of at that time. And it was actually her who actually taught me how to draw Holly.
Holly
for Christmas time. So now every Christmas I can do that for all the cards.
Oh, sure.
It's very special. But, Grandma, there were a lot of things. The bat story. We should talk about that one, bro.
Oh, the bat story? Oh, most of you who've who knew Aunt Dolly, as you call her, Grandma, she. We had this cabin over on Taylor Lake that we would have everybody come over to for sometimes some family reunions from time to time. But one night, it was Uncle Ray, Aunt Pat. Were you guys there for this one?
Grandpa. Finish the story.
Okay. well, Grandpa. This is when Grandpa was still alive, and we were all sitting down, and Grandma was telling a story about when this bat came in and landed on my dad's chest, and it was in one of the back rooms. And Alicia asks, "Oh, Grandma, is that gonna happen again?" And she says, "Oh no, honey, that can never happen again." And on cue, from that same old back room, this bat comes circling around everywhere, and the thing's just terrified out of its mind. Everybody's going, "Ah!" Grandma's covering her hair, and thinking it's gonna get in her hair, and everybody's going crazy. My dad comes out, with a hat, comes and swoops in, takes the bat, and he looks down and he realizes, wait a second, this is the same hat that we captured the bat 20 years ago. So, and then he releases the bat outside.
After he showed us, "Oh, look at the fangs on this little guy."
See, doesn't he look like a flying mouse?
Oh, Grandpa was just rolling.
Oh, Grandpa was in the background just rolling. He was just laughing at the story.
She had just put us to bed. And then she went downstairs and she told Grandpa that, "Yeah, I just told them that story." Oh.
No, you guys are still out. You were still sitting.
I was upstairs in the loft.
No, you were in the loft. You're still downstairs. Yes. No, I was. You guys are right down there, along with Tanya. Tanya's right here. You're right here. And Aura's right here. Anyway.
The story I like that Rick tells about the motorcycle. He just got in it. She gets on it. She goes, "How do you turn this thing on?" And she shows her. She's like, "You be like this?"
She took off down the street on my motorcycle. I hadn't had it in half an hour. And she didn't know where the brakes were.
They were allowed.
He needs brakes.
Yeah, and then she. This is my tribute to Helen Hoover. At the age of 2, Helen Hoover developed infantile paralysis. She was paralyzed from the chest down. Grandma Helen and Grandpa Oscar put her on a train to the hospital in Madison with a nurse she didn't know.
A creative doctor there put a metal pin in her leg to keep it straight. It was later removed with great pain. Mom was luckier than most people that had polio. She walked again. She had very little deformity. Of course, luck had nothing at all to do with it. God was watching over Mom. He had a purpose for her. Helen Huber loved her birth family and often remarked how her brothers and sisters took such good care of her. They told many stories that gave proof of it. I didn't write any down because I didn't want to expand too much. Mom lovingly took care of the Rockman Scholarship from its inception until a few years ago when she asked me to do it. Mom was the last of Oscar and Helen's 10 children to depart this earth. Now the family is all together again, complete in heaven, with our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Would love this. She loved a Rockman party. It was one of her favorite things.
And she was a poet also.
Yes, she was. And an artist. She could draw and she could write both. I heard at the last reunion that she attended, she read a poem.
I have a video of like half of that. Yeah.
I remember when all four of you girls were still at home and I was up here for the summer. I feel so sorry for you guys, but you were always told, watch out for little Nancy. Take care of little Nancy.
Then I am that girl.
Yes. Well, yeah. Because I was little. I was little Nancy. And one of you were having a party down in the basement. And your mom said to me, you can go down in that basement and you can dance if you want to. And you had boys over, and of course, in walks little Nancy. Hi guys, what you doing? And I think all of you hated me for quite a while after that. But it was your mom that told me I could do that.
Well, with the name little Nancy, when Virginia was married to Rick, he was a tall, redheaded man, and they had Nancy because Rick thought, I was so cute when I was there. When they had their little girl, he said, we are naming her Nancy. So that's how there was a big Nancy and a little Nancy.
I remember my mom would come over, and then she would go to leave. And I think other people did this too, and they'd start out door, but they would talk to your mom, and she always got worried because she had a plant there, and in the winter, the plant would get cold and die. And one time, I was along, and they started this out the door, and I was standing by your father, and I said, 10 minutes. To the dot. And I looked at him and I said, told ya. And Mom caught on.
Did you get reprimanded when you got home?
All the way home.
Uncle Riggs gave her that plant.
Oh, is that right? She was always so concerned because people would always head out the door and turn around and say something to her and let the cold air in on
her. People still do it all the time. I mean, everywhere I go, people start leaving, but find one more thing to talk about, and one more thing to talk about. Then the door gets open, then they talk some more, then they step out, but then they talk some more. Is it a rock? It's a rock.
It's a rock.
Yeah, it is.
They can't stand leaving a Rockman's behind.
Yeah. The two pictures are Mom's graduation and her marriage. Mom and Dad, their wedding. And you see that she had a blue suit. They were married in Texas. Dad was in the service. And the TAM belonged to Grandma Rockman, and when Mom was going there, because they were engaged already, they knew she'd be getting married, Grandma Rockman said, you can't get married without something on your head. Take the TAM. So she took Grandma Rockman's TAM, and that's what she did.
We live,
Karen was
I think Amanda Toots as probably the most faith-filled person. Of all the brothers and sisters, they all had a faith, but she was,
obviously so filled with her faith. I had the best conversations with her after my mother passed away, and I learned a lot about my mother during those conversations. Great family conversations. Yeah. I thank her for that.
Yeah, she thought a lot of you and Johnny.
Well, we lived close enough to Grandma so that I got to go over there after school sometimes, and she would make me Rice Krispies with honey and bananas on top. But she'd always wash my hands and she'd push all my cuticles back or something. I don't know why. And then I grew up to bite my fingernails, so that probably she didn't like that. But Natalie and I were talking about how we went to Kelly Lake all the time when we were growing up, and she was always singing.
Yeah, she was always singing.
Yeah.
Mom was not a negative thinker, ever. Karen, you talk about that. She was always quite positive. She really didn't always want to do it. She wanted us to do it, but she was very positive about it.
A lot of good ideas. She had some good songs.
Yeah.
Hit me hand on myself.
Yeah. You know, I talked about the clothes going back and forth with the boys, from Dick and Roos and down to us, finally. My sister Pat got more clothes every time because you girls and Pat were so close in line.
Pat's
and twins. Double trouble, yeah.
But I want to tell you about clothes. I was the last of four. The clothes went to Pat, and they got shipped back to me, and then I got Cindy's as well. Yeah. I had all hand-me-downs, and finally a friend of mine said to me once how much I like clothes, and she said, well, I know why you like clothes. And I said, why? She said, because you wore all hand-me-downs.
Yeah, maybe that's it.
You were so lucky.
Yeah.
I got all those clothes.
I know.
We had to break them in.
Yeah. Well, that's right. Yeah. Well, I think you get you put love and memories in them every time you wore them.
There
and
we
and the hand-me-downs, the bottom line, we got the blessings of all that.
Yeah,
it was positive.
Yeah, positive. Yeah.
Did your grandpa, our grandpa, and there's a whole bunch of us because our father, Don and Lillian's only son, had 11 children. So our grandfather, on behalf of all of us, was the twin of Dorothy, Karen and Ron's mom. And Grandpa was mentioned earlier in connection with his brother Lyle. So you see in the far picture the wedding photo of Lyle at which Don and Lil stood up. So Don and Lil were already married, and then Lyle and Delphine got married. And so anyway, my grandpa was at one point in his young life sent over to Pulsifer to live with his grandma Halla and his uncle Tom. And he stayed there because Grandpa Halla had passed, and there was some need for some help on the farm, and so he stayed during the summer and lent a hand to getting the chores done. Because of his time there, he had a special bond with his Grandma Halla, but also especially with his Uncle Tom Halla. And so in later years, when Don and Lillian had their child, Jerry, they had a hospital bill. In those days, the hospital bill for having a child was $200. And it happened that unfortunately about that time, and before Uncle Tom could meet his nephew, Uncle Tom passed, and in his will, he left Don $200. So, $200 paid for my father to be born, our father to be born. Because my mother, who is straight down the road behind me next to my father, passed at an early age,
these people, Don and Lil, my grandma and grandpa, raised me for most of my first 4 years. And so they were very much my bonded parents. And my grandfather was my moral compass. He was a very, I guess the phrase that society uses to relate to a lot of our kin, our kind, a staunch Norwegian Lutheran. He was a very firm and steady man, and it was that attribute in his professional life as an insurance salesman that caused the owner of the big boats, the iron ore boats that sail from Duluth Superior all the way through the St. Lawrence Seaway out to the Atlantic Ocean. Those, you know, half a mile long boats. My grandfather sold the insurance policy to cover those boats, ships, moving cities. And it was a deal that for whatever reason, he brought me along with him when he did business. And I saw him shake hands on a multi-million dollar insurance sale. And Mr. Frazier, the owner of the big boat, said, "Just send me the paperwork, Don. We're good. Deal's done." So a multi-million dollar contract based on my grandfather's good reputation was done on a handshake. So Don was a very respected man in his community. He served as an usher in his church. He was a member of the Masons and went all the way through the shrine. And he and his brother were of a kind. He was a scholar in the sense that he memorized poetry. He didn't always come up with it himself, but he memorized pages-long poems. And those guys would recite this stuff, and I'm in school thinking, "Oh no, don't tell me that's what I have ahead of me." But they did it just so easily. It was just a part of their life. And so he was not only a scholar, but he was a gentleman. And I remember the day the commission check for that sale came in, and Grandma Lil was probably about 2 feet off the floor, jumping up and down. "Don, look, Don, look!" They were taking care of their granddaughter and, you know, living up in Superior away from the rest of the family. So it meant a lot that they were doing well and able to provide. They loved their grandchildren. They took us camping. Camping meant they rented a cabin. There weren't tents involved, but they rented a cabin, and the girls would go up for a week, and then folks would come up and bring up the boys and take back the girls. And Grandpa bought me my first fishing license and my first fishing lure when I was in college. I fished and was able to provide food for myself as a university student in Stevens Point. So he not only fed me, but he taught me how to fish so that I could survive on my own. He was a gentleman of old world and old time values, and dearly beloved by his grandchildren.
My biggest shock, the biggest shock that I ever had about Grandpa was when we were going through the pictures, setting up his 100th birthday. He did have hair at one point. And it was dark and it was long and you could see it. I never knew, I don't think any of us knew Grandpa without just this little bit here. And every now and then he'd say, I gotta go to the barber. He says, I gotta get a haircut. He'd get it trimmed so that it was. And we're all like, there's nothing there to trim, Grandpa. But yes, he did. He did have hair.
That was awesome. And it was curly.
Yep.
Yeah, it was.
It was curly, yeah. And that's where Dad got it from, and that's for those of us who have any of it have got it from. Mm-hmm.
That was a nice shock, a very nice surprise. It wasn't a shock. It was very nice.
I know Grandpa's humor was legendary, and it rubbed off on his wife Lil. With it. I think the story goes they were playing cards. I'm not sure, but they played a lot of cards. It might have been a real argument, but apparently Grandma played a card and won, and Grandpa said to her, "You little shit." And without skipping a beat, Grandma said, "I'm just as big a shit as you are." And that was very typical of Grandpa's humor. I was surprised to hear that from her.
Oh, Grandma was sassy.
And Grandpa used to like to photograph too. He had all the equipment where you camera, and then you make it into slides, and then slide projector. And when we go up to Mozanine to visit him, thing always came out, and we'd watch videos of past times, past parties and stuff. It was fun.
And one of the things I remembered about him, of all the Rockman men, he wore a tie more than any of the others I ever saw. He always had his white shirt and tie on. And, you know, of course, that's what he did.
Yeah.
But so he always looked like very businesslike.
Ready for business.
And I was surprised when I saw the photo with hair, too. And what do you mean her name's not Honey?
Oh, sorry.
Who is that?
Family
full of nicknames.
Yeah. She was Lillian, and her younger, next oldest sister. Couldn't say Lily, so they said, "Oh, honey," it stuck for a lifetime. Well, for almost a lifetime. When she moved into the assisted living facility, she became Lil. For all of family, Don and Honey.
Mm-hmm. Okay, with that said, we'll. Go to Lyle's, which everybody gets on the hay wagon again, and we got to go to the Catholic site.
The Catholic site.
We have to finish. So yes, as a matter of fact, two brothers married two sisters. So Uncle Lyle and Aunt Delphine had their parents-in-law on the girls' side, right here, John and Rose Kessler, which is part of the reason why they're buried here right next to them. So the far picture again is Lyle and Delphine's wedding, and Aunt Delphine had her sister, her younger sister, Lil, who we just left over there, stand up for her. And Uncle Lyle was in the Navy. He was a Navy man, and then he also, in service to his community, was a part of the volunteer fire department. Okay, not that we wanted, this is not a proud Rockman moment, but our father, who may very well be in heaven right now, it's, you know, we don't know, but he and his relation on the Kessler side of the family, well, on Mrs. Kessler, Vitla's side of the family. Dad had a cousin, Bobby Vitla's, who was his next door neighbor, his best friend, and with whom he did all sorts of things, like take some rolled up newspaper out to the woods, along with some matches. Mm. And the volunteer fire department had to be called out, which meant that everyone on the department got an extra $5 for that week. Okay, so his father, his uncle, That's not why he did it. He and Bobby were just having fun, but unfortunately, the Rockman family and the Vitlis family made some extra money. So that was a part of Uncle Lyle's service to the community, and my father just helped him perform his duties. Yeah, that's it. But Uncle Lyle was very of a kind, as I said before, with his brother Don. Yes, the two of them could have some rollicking good fun. Uncle Lyle, as most of you probably know, owned the IGA grocery store on the corner right down the street here at the, I think, only traffic light in town. I remember going in there and thinking how incredible it was that he took on the responsibility, and he took it very seriously, of providing good, healthy food for his community. I saw how hard they worked. I would come in there and Aunt Delphine would be scrubbing shelves or mopping the floor, or there was always something to be cleaned and the food to be culled for freshness, and on it went. They were very impressive in their dedication to being professionals, quality work, quality product. Until Christmas rolls around, and because they lived right next door to Don and Honey, we would, as I was a child, have both couples, Grandma and Grandpa and Auntie and Uncle Lyle, over for Christmas dinner. And then the Manhattans. And then the stories. And then the jokes. And then I remember these two guys with red noses. And I thought, okay, it's Christmas. And they've got the red noses, and they're laughing so hard they can hardly stand up. And the rest of us are laughing because they're laughing so hard. And it was just general mayhem and hysteria. But Uncle Lyle was a very compassionate man also. He was very kind to me as a child. And I'm sure to, each of us. They did not have children, but he certainly would have been a great father. He was a very, very good, kind, and compassionate man.
I remember when he had the store, I would go in there quite often when I was uptown and just say hi. Well, one day, I decided I was going to steal something. He had all of those boxes of like penny candy right there by the cash register. And so I just kind of nonchalantly, walked over, hey Uncle Lyle, what's happening? Grabbed a candy and left. I got partway down the street and felt so guilty. I can't do this. So I went back to the store and told Uncle Lyle about it. And he says, "That's okay, little Nancy." He says, "That was really nice of you to come and admit that you did something." He goes, "So you can keep the candy." I said, I went through all of that, the apology and everything. I still got candy. This is pretty cool.
That's where it all started. He always seemed to be the tall guy in the family, too. He always seemed extra tall. I think back over the years as how he was always really, really nice to me. I think he felt bad, because my dad passed away. And so he just always would give me a little extra hug or say something extra nice to me. I didn't know him that well. But I also was impressed as we got older how he and Byron and Don, who knew weren't around each other a lot over the years, they would come together and they would just pick up a conversation just like it was yesterday. They haven't seen each other in several months. Cool, they're right back together. They're laughing, they're thinking alike, like we are. And I just think how lucky they were as brothers to have grown up together in that same family. And you guys had humor too, because I remember the song, "Yes, We Have No Bananas." And he said, this one of the neighbor ladies came in and said, you know, how come your bananas are so expensive? They're 29 cents a pound here and only, you know, 5 cents less down the other store. He said, well, why didn't you buy them down there? He said, well, we're out. He said, well, when I'm out of bananas, I sell them for a nickel a pound. So the apple didn't fall far from the tree.
Yeah, when I was a small child and living with my grandma and grandpa, he had a few little sayings, and I don't even imagine that they were just for me, but I heard them when I was with Auntie and Uncle Lyle. And so, to me, they were all just for me, because that's how they were. When you were there, it was all about you as a child, and one of them was, okay, fill in the blank with your own name and then tell me if you've heard this. My version went, Debbie, Debbie, goodness gracious, you just put that naked faces. And then, of course, because of getting Helen, great-grandma Helen's curly hair through Grandpa Don, through my dad, Jerry, I got the naturally curly hair, and then the other one was, there was a little girl who had a little curl right in the middle of her forehead. And when she was good, she was very, very good. But when she was bad, she was horrid. And there's another whole verse to that, and it's an actual poem.
Really?
Yeah, I found it.
Deb took this for me. Come on, let's talk about it. And he would just be so, so kind and so, like, down to earth with anything, every situation. He was just right there to make sure that you feel okay about whatever it is in life you're going through.
Yeah, very compassionate. Yeah, easy going. Yeah, he would have made a wonderful father.
Joyce Marion was born January 9, 1921, twin sisters to Lois. They argued for many years as to who was the youngest. Joyce had considered herself to be a black sheep of the family, as she admitted to being naughty and a bit rebellious. She fell in love with a younger man by 5 years, Jim Rick, referring to him as my Jimmy. On April 30th, 1949, they headed to Pine City, Minnesota to witness Jim's brother Bob's marriage. While they were there, they decided to get married. So for $5, they bought a ring and a marriage license. It took weeks after returning home to tell their parents they got married. After 3 years of marriage, it was time to start a family. First came Ken, followed by twins, Susan and Sandra, next Kathy, then Diane, and finally John Oscar. This large family had lots of fun and happy times living in the large house on 3rd Street, and the summers were filled with outdoor activities, camping in a tent, given to them by Dolly. 8 people in a tent for a week. How can that not be fun? The winters were at the rink for hockey, or Joyce managing the ring. After 51 years of marriage, 10 grandsons, 1 granddaughter, and 1 great-grandson, Joyce passed away from a heart attack on May 19, 2000. 1 week later, her loving husband got in a car accident on his way to the cemetery. June 11, 16 days later, he joined his wife in heaven. The family now gets together every year on their wedding anniversary to celebrate their lives and reminisce about the good old days. Aunt Joyce. This is their picture.
I am named after her, Judith Joyce.
Okay. Thank you.
Yes, it is.
Sharon Barr.
And I want to thank Larry and everybody who worked so hard to bring this all together, bring us all together. This is really, really special. Mm-hmm.
I want to say one little thing about Joyce as a younger, not as an elder. All of the brothers and sisters, you know, grandma, grandpa, all of them were just very, very special and loving. And I mean, you'd recognize them in a minute, or you'd recognize them in a laughter. But Joyce always sticks in my head with that. The only thing I can think of is just that cute little way she tilted her head and smiled and then burst out laughing.
Yep.
It was Joyce. I mean, no one else had that. No one else had that. It was just, and it's just, that's one thing that sticks out in my head about, you know, the love and the care and everything that everybody has passed down. And Joyce was just this cute little aunt that just, oh my goodness, can you help a lover?
All right, so now we'll head back to the park and we'll have some toast there.
Yep.
People are going to stay. Some people have to leave.
Oh, no.
No, the first toast is going to leave.